Welcome to The Healing Power of Self-Expression, Photography by Female Refugee Artists. We're super excited to bring you today's program in collaboration with One Journey, Art for Humanity Foundation, Penn Cinema and Media Studies, and TD Bank. Around the world, over 82 million people have been forced to flee their homes as a result of conflict, persecution, natural disasters, and other extreme events. Today, we'll explore how creativity and art are essential to helping refugees reclaim their voices and lives using photography to both express their past experiences and to share their hopes for a better future. Before we begin the panel discussion today, we're going to share a short video clip about Art for Humanity Foundation's extraordinary photography school and the great work they're doing with refugees, and in particular, female refugees in Diavata, Greece. This clip will be followed by a brief welcome from Wendy Chan, the co-founder of One Journey.
This is it. This is our world. Our small world, where everything happens. The tears, the smile, the grace, the silence, the progress, the revolution, love, hate, beauty, poetry, craziness, loneliness, peace, war, the tragedy, the killing, the sparkle, the vibes, the music, the hunger, the fear, the dream, the you and me, the us, the people, the friends, the ones we love and the ones we don't know, and everything else. It's our world, our tiny world, and it deserves to be witnessed because it's all we've got.
Hello everyone, my name is Wendy Chan, and I am the co-founder of One Journey. One Journey is a nonprofit that works to shift the narrative of refugees around the world by showcasing their talents and contributions through what we call the shared languages of humanity: food, music, arts, sports, and storytelling. One Journey creates opportunities across the country to bring the displaced and the communities together to build compassion and understanding. Our signature event, the One Journey Festival, draws thousands of participants each year to the Washington National Cathedral in June to celebrate refugee stories of resilience and hope. One Journey is founded on the belief that creative art breaks down boundaries and elevates human souls. Art has this magical ability to remind us the oneness of humanity, that while we may walk on many paths in life, we're all traveling on one journey of humanity together. We're so honored to be Arts for Humanity's U.S. exhibition partner, and we're thrilled to bring this wonderful photography project to the Perry Wheelhouse. Next, I would like to introduce our moderator, Professor Peter DeCherney. Peter is a professor of cinema and media studies at Penn and the faculty director of Penn's online learning initiative. So over to you, Peter.
Thank you, Wendy and LaShawn. It's always great to partner with Perry Wheelhouse and with One Journey. What a beautiful, inspiring, and impactful slideshow we started with. Some people have already been asking in the chat about purchasing the photographs, and you can do that at a4humanity.com and see also many more photographs. I think we have a great opportunity today to reflect on the power of art to transform the lives of creators and hopefully influence others as well. I'm delighted to welcome our speakers. Let me read their short bios, and then we'll start the panel. The first speaker is Mattia Biadoli, who's the project leader of the photography school in the refugee camp in Diavata, Greece. He's also a photographer himself. He's collaborated with a range of organizations and NGOs, including the United Nations, CIMIC, and UNHCR. Mattia has undertaken over 40 missions in Syria, Palestine, Kosovo, Lebanon, Belarus, Kenya, Tanzania, Iraq, and Greece. Our next panelist is Khalud Eid, who's a documentary photographer, filmmaker, and educator based in New York. In 2020, she was a recipient of the Robert F. Kennedy Journalism Award for Domestic Print alongside colleagues for the New York Times series, Exploited. Our next panelist, Masuma Musavi, is an 18-year-old refugee from Afghanistan. She has studied photography for 1 year and wants to become a professional photographer. Our next panelist, Ann Richards, joined Freedom House in October 2021 as a Distinguished Fellow and Afghanistan Coordination Lead. From 2012 to 2017, Ann served as Assistant Secretary of State for Population, Refugees, and Migration. A longtime Penn friend, she was a visiting fellow at the Perry World House in 2017 and 2018. And our final panelist is Masuma Tajik, a 28-year-old refugee from Afghanistan who studied photography since November 2020. She aspires to travel the world, write, and take photos. So thank you everyone for joining us and for taking the time to be here today. I wanna start by speaking with Mattia and the two Masumas, who I'll refer to as Masuma M and Masuma T, so it's clear. I also wanna mention that the photography school's photographs, not you won't be surprised if you're seeing them, won the 2021 Global Peace Photo Award. Mattia, maybe we can start with you. Could you tell us a little bit about the photography school? What's the situation like in the Diavita camp? How did the school get started? Who are the students? And how did you get involved in this?
Okay. So first of all, good evening to everybody, because here in Greece, it's an evening. It's a pleasure to be there. So I come here totally by chance. I was in another refugee camp, and I come here in Diavata, it's in the northeast of Greece. And here I found something that I never found in any other camp. I found a safe space for women run by QRT, Quick Response Team. And I thought, wow, this, like you said in the video, it's an oasis. It's amazing because normally, you know, in Muslim countries, women are not supposed to do a lot of things. So to create a safe space for them where they can be free, where they can have education, self-expression, or even a place to feel more free, I thought it was an amazing idea. And I see that immediately the huge amount of work that it was doing. And I thought this is the perfect place to do something like this, to start a photography school. So I spoke with the coordinator of QRT and I said, I would love to come back there, stay more time and to start this this journey, this project, this photography class. And so here is how I ended up in Greece. At the beginning was not the most easy thing to do because I'm still a man with a camera and, you know, like someone, one of the girls told me once, a lot of people come with cameras to us and they will want to have the sad stories and stuff like this. And so I thought instead of being another man taking photos of them, it's better if I give them the power to empower them to tell their own story, to their own vision on the world. And thanks to the safe space that allowed them to be there, to be free, to don't feel afraid that this is was possible and is still possible. So that's how I end up there in this place.
No, that's amazing. Why bring art to a refugee camp at all? And why photography and not some other medium? Is there something about photography itself that has a certain kind of power?
Oh yeah, I experienced different kinds of art during my life, but I fall in love with photography because, for example, if you are like a painter or a sculptor, you just take like a piece of paper and you try to reproduce like, a reality or your vision. With photography, the reality, it's your canvas. So, and it's more immediate. Somebody cannot be able to draw, somebody cannot be able to paint, but a camera, literally in 10 minutes, you can start to learn it. You can immediately saw the result. And so that's why I choose photography, or photography choose me. Still, I don't even find the answer right to this.
Yeah, I wonder if you could just tell us a little bit more about how you create a safe space and a space for inspiration for the photographers.
So the safe space was already existing before. It's a safe space in the camp of Diavata. And it's a safe space where there's providing education. Like, for example, it's just, as I told you before, it's just for girls and women. So there is educational, like they learn languages like German and English, but also yoga, art. So the girls was already used to have this kind of safe space and to learn this kind of art things. And so this, that was the natural step, the space already existing. So it's the girls are already know this place. Also, the people of the camp know the place, know the NGO, and they trust the NGO because you remember there are just girls there. So, and some of the girls are underage. For example, in the photography class, we have girls from 14 years old to 34 years old. So the people let the girls come there. So it's the perfect place to do something like this because they trust on us and first.
Yeah, great. So let's turn to the photographers for a minute. Masuma M, maybe you can start. Tell us a little bit about how you first learned about the photography program, what attracted you to it, and how has it impacted your life?
So good evening, everybody. So I lived in the camp for 4 years and a half, and then we left the camp and I was living in the center of the city. So a friend of mine who was in the class recommended me to come and because like for fun, I just came for fun, but it had a huge impact in my life. And it's totally changed my future, my opinion, everything. It had a huge impact on my life. And I think when you become a photographer, you see the world in a different way. Every detail in the around you is special and it's unique. And the thing that you can make memories and you can show with photos how you can show your feelings, you can show the world who you are actually. The goal of this photography class was to show the world that we girls are not refugees, you know, to show ourselves as artists, not only a refugee who came from another country. And that was the thing that attracted me most, that there is someone that wants us to be ourselves, not only refugees, to show ourselves as artists.
Yeah, what an amazing description of what it's like to kind of see with a camera and work with a camera and create art. I wonder if you could tell us a little bit about how people have responded to your work.
So, I have some friends we had some exhibitions and I had invited them and they were so proud, you know, they were so happy and they wanted me to continue what I want to do and I have to do what I want to do, you know, like not whatever the other people say or what I should do, what is in my heart. So I had a little problem with my family, but I can convince them.
May I ask a little bit about that? How your family responded and what you had to convince them of?
I am with my siblings and half of them were like, no, do something better, need more money, something engineering, doctor or something like that. I'm actually studying in a school, in a vocational school, the dental technique. Now I want to become a professional. I want to become a professional photographer because it totally changed my whole future, but I can't convince them.
So I know we asked you to just choose one photo. We'd love to see them all, but just to choose one photo to talk about. So maybe we can put that on the screen and we'd love to have you tell us the kind of story of this photo, what you were trying to do and why this is one of your favorites.
So we had to, for our exhibition, our subject was home. So Mattia asked us all girls that, what is home for you? And for me, home is my parents and my religion and my belief. And it totally, I told him that my parents, I don't have with them, they don't exist, but I still have them with me in my heart and wherever I go, and they're my strengths and motivation. And home is this is home for me. I wanted to show what is home for me.
Have you done other self-portraits?
No, I've done here on this photography class.
The one with the fingers.
Oh, yes, I know, I've done
the
others.
The one that's in the video.
The one with the fingers, yeah. So it was about when some refugees come with different look and different clothes and they wear some hijab and scarf, and they stare at you in a different way and they don't treat you, some of them, they don't treat you like normal people, you know, and it's weird, and we don't feel good, you know, because we want to be treated as normal people. And that's what I want to show that.
Yeah, no, your work is you know, really beautiful and powerful. And I think that definitely comes through really, really strongly. We'll come back. I'm gonna go ahead, Mattia.
This because I have the chance to speak with her bigger brother, older brother.
Yes.
Because the first time that I met her brother was at the first exhibition when he attended. And I was with her and I asked, so what do you think about the photos of her brother on your sister? And yeah, it's okay. But then I see them without the sister. So now, you know, I can tell you the truth because I'm the older brother. I always have to be very, very mean with her because she's my younger sister. I'm incredibly proud of her because the way she can express herself and put her inside on the outside.
No, amazing. No, I love that description too, right? Of create showing your taking your inside outside, and it's exactly what you see in the case. So just to turn to Masuma T, I kind of want to ask you some of the same questions. How did you find out about the school? What brought you there? And can you tell us about what happened the first time you started to use a camera?
First, hello to everybody. And if I want to say about the first time when I saw the camera, it was about a few years ago when I was in Iran. My friend had a camera and she used to go outside to practice and take some pictures. And one day she asked me to go with her and I joined and I start taking some pictures. And then I took a photo of her. And when I took a photo, I didn't care about around myself, but when I took a photo of her and when I look at the camera and I check the photo, I don't know what happened really, but now I believe it, that the eyes talk. And when I look at her eyes in the photo, I'm shocked. And I said, okay, she needs me, I don't know. I need to go just to hug her and to tell her that you are not alone. And through the photo, I saw something really different. And it was a huge thing that until now, and sometimes I'm looking at her eyes, I feel that feeling that I had in the past. And also here, because I'm living in the camp near this place, I met Mattia. Yes, I met Mattia 1 year ago. Yeah.
One year and four months.
At first, I really couldn't trust him, to be honest. trusting the men, but the men from my country that I used to see them, it's really difficult to trust a man. But after that, really, I don't know what happened, but I felt that, okay, he's different. And also he's different all the other people that I met before. So I started taking pictures and then it became really serious. and that we had a lot of exhibition, not a lot, but okay, we had. And what else? You know, I lost.
No, that's okay. I'm curious about, you told us a story about what happened when you saw your own photograph. Can you tell us about what happens when other people see your photographs? Do they see what you see? Have you been surprised by reactions?
Okay. I'm still So when Mattia told us that we have an exhibition or we have an online interview, I have a lot of stress, and I'm always thinking about it, that what the other people will think about us, because, okay, we are refugee. We are refugee girls, we are refugee women, and this word, refugee, it means a lot for us, and I see a lot of reaction of the people, and I am always scared of this, that what people think about us. And but every time when we had or we have something to about us, our photos to show to some people, I see that I was wrong, and I see that the people, when they see our photos, they shock and they say, this is amazing. This is look like a gun. You are talking without explaining, without saying anything. Your photos is talking with us. And I see that a lot of people, they told me that your photos, your work is really, really good. And they love.
Yeah, they see it expressing something they're feeling, feeling too. So it builds a connection.
Yeah, a lot.
I guess I to come back in a second, Mattia. There's actually a good question in the Q&A. It might be interesting to bring in now. But someone's asked specifically about the kinds of assignments you give. There's definitely the work is very of different photographers. Is, you know, it seems definitely connected. What kinds of assignments do you use to try to just inspire and stimulate?
Let's start with the basic of the cameras, but like in a kind of funny way, because photography can be a little bit boring from a technical point of view. And then because I have different classes and different groupies, I wait for them to be ready, because also in the photography class, we not only take photos, we speak a lot. We know each other and stuff like this. So when there is the right moment, I can start to show them that photography is not only taking beautiful pictures, but can be pictures with a meaning. So in all the classes always start like the same. It's like the most easy and difficult story at the same time to talk about is ourselves. So for example, to give you a practical example, we start with emotions. So we type, the girls write a series of emotions, and then we choose like, for example, okay, love. Okay. And each girl says, what, I'm not thinking about the photo, but what is love for me? And then we speak freely about what is love. And then we start, okay, how can I put this in a photo? So some of the works, it's very like, some of the work is like conceptual, but at the same time, just going around, like for example, when we do with the NGO food distribution, we take photos of this. And when there are activities there in the safe space, we take photos of it. So it's very different. Or for example, when we've been contacted by MSF, Doctors Without Borders, the project like the one of Massimo showed the photo about homeless. So they give us a theme like home, and we take the theme and we spoke about, and each one of us give a different opinion about what is home for us, and then we come up with a photo that can express this the most perfect way for each one.
I want to talk about one of my photos.
Yes. I was going to ask you about, we will put that on the screen now. Great to have you talk about that. And if it's a response to one of these, one of Mattia's prompts or something else.
Yeah, I took this photo a few weeks ago because we usually go to another camp every Friday to another camp to distribution something to the people. And one day I see that, okay, I have my camera and I start walking in the camp, and I saw a cage on a cabinet in front of a container. Okay, because I'm always thinking about the cage. It's one thing that I feel it a lot. And I took a photo of that. And when I went to see that what my friend are doing, when I came back, I saw again the cage, but in a stage. And I don't know really, but what will happen or what happened. So I took again a picture and I start walking and going around the camp and taking some pictures of the animals, of the children and some other things. And by chance, when I was coming back, I came back through the container that I saw the cage. And then I see this photo. I see this this girl that she's standing in front of the fence and she's holding that cage that I saw it maybe 10 minutes before it. And I saw that she's looking outside. And I was shocked and I took a photo of her. And then I sat there a little bit and I started watching her. And a lot of questions came in my mind. And I said, okay, what she's looking for, or what she's thinking. And then I said, okay, I can understand this girl. Okay, she's not as my age, but okay, I can understand because I'm also a refugee like her. I'm living in a camp. I understand what feelings she has now. And I just closed my eyes and I said, okay, maybe she's thinking about the road, that does it have an end or not? Is anyone there to help her? You know, a lot of questions came in my mind, and then when I look out carefully, I saw, what's that name? I forgot the name.
The traffic sign?
Yes, yes, the traffic sign. I saw that there is a shape of people. There is two, but she's alone. She's one person. And again, I see that, okay, maybe she feels lonely. And when she turns, I went to her and I asked, okay, what did you think? What you are thinking about what? And she said to me, I'm thinking about the future. And for this girl that maybe she is 8 or 9 years old, she say this word that I'm thinking about the future. And I just asked her, do you know what is future? She said, yes, 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 I know. It's the things that all the time my parents think about it. And she didn't know what is future. She just see the things that her parents talking. And I became so sad. I really felt pain in my heart, really. I wanted to cry, but I controlled myself, and now I'm thinking about it. I feel so bad. And I said, okay, let me do another thing. So let me ask her what is her wish or what are her wishes. And maybe I be able to do one of them for her. And when I ask her, what is your wishes? What is your wish or what are your wishes? And she answered me, what is wish? And for 8, 9 years old girl, I think this is really bad. I mean that maybe there was no one, okay, for the limited, for the things that she didn't have, it was that she said, I don't know what is wish. She asked me, what is wish? And I became so sad. Why a girl should be staying in the camp behind this fence and this wall also, and doesn't know what is wish? And I said, okay, who knows how the living, how is the living in the camp, what this girl is thinking? And I said, okay, I understand. I can, because I'm one of these people. And I just took, I saved the photos and I came and I showed it to Mattia and I said, okay, I choose it. And I hope someone help not only this girl. There are a lot of girls that they need They are really nice, they are beautiful, they are talented, they have a lot of skills, but there is no one. There are, okay, but they need more help. They need people to take care of them, to see them, not only, okay, because talking is easy. Talking about something is really easy, but they need someone to act, to do something for them.
Yeah, no, what an amazing, powerful story of the photo. And I just have to say, you kind of feel all of that in that photo as well. And even though I didn't know all the context, you know, it also raises all these questions, you know, for me that are in many ways connected to your questions, and definitely the kind of longing and sadness is there too. So Halud, I wonder if we could just turn to you for a minute. People probably don't know about your amazing, not everyone will know about your amazing works. I'm hoping that we'll send them to your Instagram and site and website, but maybe you could just tell us a little bit about the kind of work you do.
Yeah, well, first I just want to say that the work has been fantastic. Masuma Tajik, that was really beautiful and compassionate and a beautiful image. And yeah, Masuma Musavi, you're much braver than I am. I'm scared of self-portraits. So yeah, beautiful work from both of you. And Peter, so I guess where to begin? Just the work that I've been doing or that I'm drawn to.
What are you drawn to? What kind of subjects, what kind of people, what kind of stories? Yeah.
So for the most part, I've started to gravitate more towards portraiture lately, but in general, stories involving identity or concepts of home have been something that have resonated with me personally. I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that I'm Palestinian American. So both of my parents were born in Palestine. And you know, when I was younger, I lived there for a few years and I would also go visit. And I started thinking, God, I wish people could actually see exactly what I'm seeing. And so I think that is in line with a lot of what I do. I'm drawn to quieter stories. I think that you can tell very complicated stories in a more nuanced and quiet way. I don't think that every picture has to be like bang, bang, bang. And, you know, it's interesting, you guys are talking about pictures that raise questions. There's kind of the mantra of my photography lately has been, Gary Winogrand once said, I'd rather my pictures raise more questions than answers. And that seems kind of counterintuitive as a photojournalist. As a photojournalist, you know, you feel like your role is to inform the public. And that is absolutely the case, but I think I also like to try to engage people and bring them in and have them asking what it is that I'm working on so that they can delve a little deeper and they can kind of explore on their own terms. And with photojournalism in particular, I think, you know, I have the luxury of having captions accompany my pictures. So my picture could be anonymous portraits, but the caption is going to give the context of where those people come from. So yeah, that's kind of what I've been doing lately.
Yeah, I know that's such a great description of some of the work I've seen, that these kind of quiet stories, but also that can inform and ask questions at the same time, even if that seems like they're two different projects. I wonder if you could talk to us a little about the ethics. I know something you've thought a lot about, the ethics of photographing people at risk and telling other people's stories and the kind of the burden or challenge that you have from doing that.
I mean, first off, I look at it as a blessing anytime someone gives access to their home. no one owes journalists or photographers that kind of access and intimacy. But once you gain that, you have an obligation to the people that you're photographing to represent them in a fair way, in a way that is compassionate. And I think when it comes to, I've photographed a lot of anonymous portraits, it's become kind of a weird niche of mine. Like now sometimes editors will call me specifically for those kinds of stories. As far as the ethics goes, I mean, the most important thing is that you're doing right by the people that you're photographing, the individuals. As far as the ethics goes, you know, really making sure that you're protecting their identity if they're at risk. So for instance, I recently did a story for National Geographic where Nina, the writer, and I went to a handful of different towns in the US that have the highest populations of refugees and migrants per capita. And we met a father and an Afghan father and daughter, and they evacuated. They evacuated during the fall of Kabul. And you know, it was one of those things where his wife and three other kids are still back in Afghanistan. So it was just absolutely important that I not put them or their family at risk. And so with that, I think it requires a lot of communication, a lot of making sure that people are comfortable, that you're respectful. And that applies to any story, whether it's, whether the people are at risk or not. I think you just always want to treat people with the respect and compassion that they deserve. With that, it's making sure that their names are not used, making sure that the metadata, the information in the files aren't giving up, you know, specific locations, if that's something that needs to also be hidden. So it's a lot of communication with the people you're photographing, with your editor, with a writer, if you're working with one. And then there's a bunch of also ethics with like representation and all that too. So, you know.
Yeah, no, that's really helpful. I wonder if you could just tell us your reactions, responses to the work of Masuma and other photographs that you've seen from this. Does it connect with work you've done, or you know, if you either could talk about it formally or emotionally, however you want to respond?
Yeah, both Masumas have made really beautiful work. And I think, I feel like sometimes the more constraints you have, the more creative you can be. I teach photography as well. And so I think sometimes when I have a very open prompt for students, they get overwhelmed because of anything that they can photograph. But I think there's a lot of beauty and magic in transcending your whatever restrictions that you might have in order to create something that resonates with you. And if it resonates with you, it's going to resonate with other people. And so absolutely a lot of the photography I've seen, I'm drawn to that kind of work. I'm drawn to work that explores, you know, memory and trauma. Those are things that you can't, an identity, and there isn't like a tangible thing that represents a lot of that. So I think you have to be kind of conceptual and work with compositional elements that can kind of convey that mood, that the point that you're trying to share with people. So I've loved them. And also Masuma M, I just want to give a shout out. Love the kafaya in your picture as a Palestinian, you know. So seeing things like that. So, you know, she relied on details in order to tell a story that she might not be able to physically tell in person. And it's a difficult one. How do you visualize something that's already happened or something that's inside of you. And so there are things like the cafeia for me, it's synonymous with resistance and a pursuit, a struggle. And that's just based on where I'm coming from as a Palestinian. So I think, and then seeing the Quran, that's something that also resonates with me. And so I think when you're, there are smart ways to convey your story. And that's definitely one of them where you're incorporating details that that give insight to you. And I think also, I think with Masuma Tajik, when we were, I think, you know, you were talking about how people react to your photos, and it's something where once you take a picture, it's released into the world. It's like a bird, it just goes, and you don't know who's going to engage with it and how it resonates, unless, you know, they come back and tell you. But when you're using, I mean, photography is a universal language. Visuals, we're living in such a visually literate society right now, and one where people are engaging and sharing more through imagery. So, you know, I think the pictures really speak to that. And every person's going to react and engage with a picture differently. And that's kind of the beauty of it. It's because I'm Palestinian, I see those things, but maybe someone else, you know, who's been separated from their parents are going to see something else. I love the work. I love all of the work.
Yeah, no, that's really helpful. Thank you. I just want to bring Anne in too, and then we'll get to all of the questions. Lots of great questions have been asked. So Anne, with your so much experience globally in different refugee camps and communities, have you seen other projects like this that try to help, you know, enable, empower refugees to create art? And if so, are there connections? Why aren't there more, if that's also the case?
Yeah, I think, Peter, that where you will see art in refugee camps or settlements is that art can sometimes be used to help small children who have been traumatized and don't have the vocabulary or may have even lost the ability to speak about what's happened to them. Painting or coloring can help them tell the story of what they've just been through. And so I've seen many, many artworks from young children that show people fighting, that show bombs dropping from airplanes, that show really shocking things that no child should have to see. And so that's both art for art's sake, but also art for the psychosocial welfare of large groups of children. I haven't seen as many. I have seen some photography courses, but I haven't seen many. And I think part of the sense is that the UN agencies, the Red Cross agencies, and the Red Cross societies, and the non-governmental organizations that help refugees around the world are always scrambling for money. And they put out an appeal to raise money to help refugees survive. And they get in less money than they ask for. And so what gets funded are things like the basics, food, shelter, things that we all need to survive. But what gets cut from budgets are things that help people thrive. And you can hear from these young women that before they had these photography lessons, yeah, they were, you know, looking for something in their lives. And then the photography lessons just added a whole dimension, a creative outlet, you know, a sense of identity that they may not have had beforehand. And so I think that that is really, really important.
Yeah, no, I think that's important. I would even say sometimes you need art to survive, not just to thrive, that it's a basic necessity and part of life. And I just wonder if you could tell us, I know you've about any specific examples you've seen working with refugees and refugee artists.
Part of what has happened to me is when you travel so much and go around the world and visit refugees in different countries, you see over and over again that life in a camp can be incredibly stultifying. You heard in the presentation ahead of our panel discussion, they use the word static. And so it can be very, very boring and uninspiring to be put into a camp. And people are trying to live as normal as possible. And that's why actually most refugees do not live in camps, they live in cities. They do what most of us would do is they try to get out of a camp and go and live as normal a life as possible, to go to school, to get jobs if at all possible. Sometimes it's not allowed, but to be self-supporting, take care of themselves, to set up their lives so that they have privacy, so that they have identity and can pursue their interests. And that's why I thought this term oasis of hope was particularly strong in talking about the photography class and the center for these young women. So yeah, I have seen beautiful art all over the world, including there have been programs that I saw for Syrian war victims to teach them how to make these beautiful mosaics that were historically something that came out of Syria, but were kind of being revived by the Orient Foundation because people were just stuck and had nothing, no inspiration. And so they were being taught a piece of their heritage to bring that back. And I thought that that was pretty inspiring and beautiful.
Yeah, no, that's a great example. Another way of using art to kind of connect to history and not to, yeah.
One of the things I wanted to let you know was that I found working in the government in 2015 and 2016, when it got so politically charged, that art for me became a haven for me. Now, of course, I'm much, much better off, always have been, than people who live in refugee camps. And we all, you know, learn by working with refugees how much we take for granted in our lives. But it became so politically charged, so nasty at times, the discussion that refugees were terrorists, that people traveling to the US borders were rapists or criminals. And I found that really, really very depressing and dismal. And so one of the things I was invited to do was to give a talk at the Metropolitan Museum of Art about the threat to beautiful historic antiquities from war, and trying to preserve them in places like Afghanistan and in Syria. And I am the daughter of an art teacher, I'm the niece of an art teacher, and my aunt was in the audience. And I think it was her proudest moment for me that I was actually addressing the head of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. She didn't see that coming in my career, working as a diplomat and as an aid expert. The other thing is I went to the studio of Ai Weiwei in Berlin and talked to him about the movie he was then making, which became Human Flow. And he went around the world and told the story in film of refugees. And I was able to give him some advice about where to go and what populations to include. They were definitely filming a lot in Europe, but I, you know, suggested, for example, the Rohingya in Bangladesh, that was really, you know, such an interesting and sad situation that should be included. And so they later invited me to the Venice Film Festival. So places you don't expect to end up when you're working with refugees all the time. So those are for me the silver linings to working on you know, trying to get money, trying to convince people to support refugees, trying to convince people that refugees are not terrorists, they're beautiful young women who have talents.
Yeah, no, thank you, Anne. No, that's really helpful. Just thinking about how, you know, art is just part of everyone's lives. And something LaShawn's always, you know, saying is refugees need to be artists just because they're whole people, and creating art is part of life.
Me about these photos, though, is that, yeah, you know, sometimes as Americans or Westerners, we have to get a lot of equipment to do things. And you see these beautiful photographs and they feature a piece of cloth, a piece of paper that's been written on, maybe some ordinary household things, a book, a mirror, and then that bird cage, of course. Even the shadow of the bird cage tells such an amazing story. And so they have had been able to do such moving pictures without much stuff. So I'm very, very impressed.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Yes, did you want to respond? Someone?
I was saying thank you very much. It means a lot that you all love it. Our work, thanks a lot.
Yes, that also echoes Khalid's point that that sometimes the best art comes from limitations. And so I just want to get to some of the audience questions. There's lots of them here. So one for Masuma and Masuma, what are the gender obstacles the two photographers have encountered and how have they overcome them?
Who want to go first?
For me, actually, it's been for me a year and a half that I don't live in the camp. And but still, it's different because normally, the in our countries, you know, girls don't have so much opportunity to do art things, you know, things about like art, like photography or anything about art. And it is weird for some people, for example, from our country or anywhere. But personally, I didn't have any experience like that, but still it's a little difficult and it will take time for them to understand this.
The other times that we went to the camp to take pictures, I was in the hospital, I was in the camp and I couldn't. But two times in our camp, I went and I started taking pictures of something, the people and other things. And can I say that we cannot?
You can say whatever you want. You're no more in Afghanistan.
Okay.
go.
Okay, you know, there is something that in our camp, we cannot take pictures. But we do. We do. It's okay. And I remember one time.
Wait, sorry. In the camp, you're not supposed to take pictures at all?
And no, they don't let us. The rule, I don't know, whatever.
It's a rule in Greece.
Yes.
In the camps, you're not allowed.
Yeah. So do they know you have a photography school?
They know.
They know. And also, one time the security saw me, that he saw me that I have a camera and taking pictures of AK. He didn't say anything and I did my work. And I didn't feel something bad, that it's difficult, because also the first time, yes, I had a stress, but first I should say that I'm really lucky to have siblings that really support me, and they stayed with me, and they said, okay, if you want to do this, do it. And when I took the camera and I said, okay, I want to take some pictures in the camp, they said, okay, if you don't feel safe or something like this, I can come with you. And I remember my oldest brother came with me. And that was a really good thing for me, that he's supporting me. And I took my photos and I didn't feel something bad, because I felt that, okay, at least there is someone that is supporting me, and he doesn't want to give me feeling bad things or unsafe, something like this. But okay, and also I took photos in the street in the city. For sure, I was scared what the people think about me, and because I had my scarf, I had my hijab, and so it's a really difficult. And I scared that, okay, maybe someone can say, why you take a picture of me? Okay, because here, all the people, okay, they know, without hijab, they understand, okay, we are refugee. And I thought that, okay, if someone came and said, okay, you are a refugee there and you came and take a photo of me, why? I scared of this a lot. But as I said that we showed the photos, our photos to the people, I was wrong that the people loved all of them. Some of them cried, some of them, one of them, it was a teacher. She was a teacher and she said, okay, this is today, it was a lesson for me. I think that I'm in the school and I'm in the university I'm studying. Today it's a lesson for me. And taking the picture of the other people in the camp or outside the camp, no. They didn't say anything and they were really good and, but okay. But I don't know, this is my problem, that all the time I'm thinking what the people think. And but I did it, I continued, and no one said. And at the end, I see that, okay, everything is okay.
Yeah, no, that's very, very interesting. I wonder if that resonates with you. What do you tell people when they're reluctant to have their photograph taken?
Yeah, it resonates for sure. And I think, you know, one thing that really helps is kind of slowing down and just communicating and being respectful. So if someone doesn't want to be photographed, that's fine. You know, I never want a person to feel pressured or that they don't have a say. I think it's kind of going back to ethics. I really am trying to work in a way that's a little bit more collaborative where, you know, consent is really important. I think a lot of times with the stories that I have, you know, I connect and I try to find people who will agree to be photographed. And then from there, a lot of times the stories are tough. So you go slow, you go, you're patient and you have to be empathetic. And again, it's all part of the ethics, like you were talking about, is how would I want to be represented? How would I want to be treated? How would I want a photographer to come into my home? But as a photojournalist, a lot of times people don't want their picture taken because a lot of times it's not a happy story. But I think it's also important to just kind of keep in mind why you're photographing. And if you're able to communicate that to someone, why you're telling their story, I think that they more often than not, they'll come around and yeah.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. So this flew by and it was amazing. And I just want to see more and more of the work coming out of the photography school. We have to sort of come to a conclusion. So I just want to thank Mattia and both Masumas for joining us all the way from Greece. Thank you, Anne and Khalud, for speaking with us. Really, really amazing to have your perspective. I learned so much about myself about the power of photographs, both to heal, to tell stories, and to connect with other people. Thank everyone for joining us. This is Perry Worldhouse's first global lens of 2022. We expect the rest to be in person, or hybrid. So please go to Locust Walk so you can go to the beautiful building again. Please join Perry Worldhouse next Tuesday, February 8th, for the World Today Presents. The program is Russia's disinformation campaign against the U.S. and its citizens from 4 p.m. to 5:15 with Konstanty Borovoy and Mitchell Ornstein. And also, please look out for announcements from the One Journey Festival in Washington, D.C. on June 25th. Amazing experience. I really hope to be there myself this year. You can find a recording of this conversation on the Perry Worldhouse YouTube channel. So thank you all again for being here today. And before we go, we'll play the virtual photography exhibit one last time. I definitely want to see it again. So I hope you'll stick around too.